governed by the Member Conservation Authority. As a corporate body, we have a board of directors. The board of directors are elected from our 72 member council. The council is made up of two representatives from each of the 36 conservation authorities, and we meet 5 times a year. In our last election for the board of directors, both Wayne and Walters were elected to our board of directors. We're also funded by the Member Conservation Authority. So the member authority, the 36th, established under the Conservation Authority Act. We have collected information on their finances, funding sources for all 36 conservation authorities. 43% is municipal, 19% is provincial, 2% federal, and 36% is from self-generated revenue. Combined expenditures of over $284 million. 100,000 kilometers of jurisdiction, 13.4 million people. This is a map of the conservation authorities in Ontario. You'll notice they're primarily focused in southern Ontario. That's where the majority of the population of Ontario resides. Almost 90% of Ontario's population are covered within conservation authority jurisdiction. You'll see that there's a 5 in northern Ontario in the inset map. And those are situated where there are major population centers in the north. So the mandate of the Conservation Authority share is to ensure the conservation, restoration, and responsible management of Ontario's water, land, and natural habitat. In terms of the business that Conservation Ontario does, excuse me as I read this, because if you let me just add this through it, I would talk too long. So, the Conservation Ontario office staff work on behalf of the conservation authorities, developing common positioning, advocating conservation authority concerns and issues, key decision makers and stakeholders, building important partnerships, and promoting essential work done by the conservation authorities. Because today's orientation is focused on planning and regs, I was just going to spend a couple of slides highlighting some of the Conservation Ontario accomplishments that relate to planning and regs in particular. There is much more that Conservation Ontario does, but the purpose of today I thought would make sense. So in terms of support to the Section 28 regulations program, we've been focused on efforts at streamlining, technical support, policy, provincial policy and guideline review and input, and support issue management. So in terms of efforts to streamline, we've been working with a multi-agency stakeholder team for the Drainage Act, coming out of best management protocols to streamline the relationship between those two pieces of legislation. That's being done with a team of CA experts are involved in, as well as Conservation Ontario staff. As well, we worked on a memorandum of understanding with Hydro One to streamline their activities and their relationship to Section 28 regs. In terms of technical support, the regulatory compliance staff or frontline staff in our watershed and Conservation Ontario pulled together a team of conservation authority staff in this program area. Barb Burrows and your authority is part of that. And we looked at providing support to that program area. So some of the outcomes from that is a protocol for a conservation authority designation of provincial census officers, as well as design and delivery of a 5-day training session, level 1 regulatory compliance training session that was delivered in the spring of 2011. That was the Minister of Natural Resources paid for half the person per CA to attend that training. As well, we hired a consultant to work on some draft recommendations for guidelines for wetland environmental impact study, requirements that were done quite extensive by science and literature review and a review of best practices, and that's been shared with the Conservation Authority. In terms of provincial policy guidelines for review, the provincial policy statement under the Planning Act is going through a 5-year review. We coordinated conservation authority input into that provincial
Region Conservation Authority doing a strategic plan. I'm working with Kawartha Region updating their watershed planning and reg policies and doing a strategic plan with them. And I work extensively with Lake Central Region Conservation Authority. Right now, I'm working extensively with Chris on defining policies for source water protection across the South Georgia Bay Lake Simcoe source protection region. So the purpose of the review was really to produce and complete a comprehensive review, program review of the plan services that were offered by the Navajo Valley PA. And there were, many of you will be familiar, a number of concerns that were expressed around the role, mandates, responsibilities of NVCA, not the least of which focused on timeliness of review, duplication and overlap, particularly with municipal planning authorities, the value for service that brings into context the whole issue of fees, enforcement capability, and effectiveness. We need to identify areas where improvement was needed and could be improved upon. And so we looked at improving process efficiencies and effectiveness, increasing process understanding, predictability, and transparency of decision making, optimizing professionalism, promoting a knowledge intensive organization. Because successful programs like the plan of service are those that remain open to continuous feedback. And really, what we focused on specifically were the services that NVCA offers under the Planning Act, so the advisory role, and the regulatory responsibilities under the Conservation Authorities Act. And I think from the presentations this morning, we've heard from Wayne, supplemented by Bonnie, that there are two very distinct roles, an advisory function and a regulatory function. And so the methodology really looked at a three-phase approach. We collected data, we reviewed and assessed and analyzed that data, and we produced a report. Then the last 10 years. Since 2001, look at the slew of new legislation, policies, and plans at the provincial level that have come forward. The Overage Moraine Conservation Act and Plan, the Species at Risk Act, Small Communities Legislation, Provincial Policy Statement, Greenbelt Act, generic regulation affecting all conservation authorities across Ontario, changes to the Municipal Act, Clean Water Act, the growth plan for the Greater Golden Horseshoe, we're embarking on the growth plan for Northern Ontario, for those that are following some of these additional initiatives. We have Endangered Species Act announced in 2007, Brownfields legislation, Green Energy and Green Economy Act, growth plan, as I mentioned, for Northern Ontario, and right now we're smack dab in the middle of a PPS five-year review, the review of the provincial policy statement. So there have been huge changes, huge implications for planning that has altered the landscape in recent years. That said, there were concerns raised around the increase in municipal levy, the scope of involvement by NVCA, the relationship with stakeholders. Right now, the current funding formula is based on a revenue self-generation model. It depends on a number of external factors. On that note, I just want to, as an aside, Alicia, make note of some work that CBC, is Credit Valley Conservation, is doing on sustainable funding. They're developing a sustainable funding strategy. And they have noted that sustainable funding does not mean the infusion only of fiscal resources. It means the infusion of human resources to complete the work of a conservation authority, and they're putting in place measures to advance a sustainable funding strategy. There's work that I'd be happy to share with Wayne if you're keen on the material that has come forward from Credit Valley before I forget. We talked about the need for better communication, the rationale for why funds are, why are the fees increasing? What's the rationale? Need to better communicate.